In 1992, NASA purchased several Soviet space reactors from the newly collapsed Russian Federation. They paid real money. They took physical possession, they transported the hardware to American facilities, and then they discovered something remarkable. They legally could not study what they had just bought. The reactors were topaz 2 units, thermionic space power systems that had actually flown in orbit aboard the Cosmos satellites. These were not prototypes or mock-ups. They were operational nuclear reactors designed for space, flight-proven hardware, representing decades of Soviet research into a technology the United States had largely abandoned. NASA wanted them desperately. The Cold War was over. Cooperation was the new paradigm. The price was negotiated. The deal was done. But American nuclear secrecy law does not care about cooperation or paradigm shifts. It cares about something called restricted data, a legal classification created by the Atomic Energy Act of 1954 that operates outside the normal framework of government classification. Restricted data is born classified. Any information concerning the design of nuclear weapons or the production of special nuclear material is restricted data the moment it comes into existence, regardless of who generates it, regardless of where it originates, regardless of whether the government wants it classified. The Topaz 2 reactor used uranium-235 fuel. It operated through thermionic conversion, generating electricity directly from heat without moving parts. The core reached temperatures exceeding 1800 Kelvin. Neutron flux in the active zone approached 10 to the 13th neutrons per square centimeter per second. The reactor mass was approximately 320 kilograms, producing roughly 6 kilowatts of electrical power. These specifications were known. The Soviets had published them, but understanding how those specifications were achieved, how the reactor actually functioned in detail, that required analysis. NASA engineers wanted to conduct comparative shielding studies. The Soviet approach to radiation shielding differed fundamentally from American designs, where U.S. space reactor concepts relied on shadow shields and geometric optimization. Topaz 2 employed a different philosophy, one that potentially offered mass savings for certain mission profiles. Understanding that approach required measuring radiation fields, mapping neutron and gamma distributions, analyzing material compositions and geometries. All of that touched restricted data. They wanted to measure neutron flux distributions with precision. The thermionic fuel elements in Topaz were configured in ways that American designers had not pursued. The neutron economy of the core, the way fission neutrons were moderated and absorbed and reflected, this was fundamental reactor physics. It was also information about how to design a compact nuclear reactor using highly enriched uranium. The measurements themselves would generate new, restricted data. Reactivity control mechanisms were of particular interest. Topaz 2 used rotating beryllium reflector segments to control the chain reaction. The geometry of those reflectors, their exact composition, the control algorithms that governed their movement, all of this represented solutions to problems that American space reactor programs had struggled with. But analyzing reactivity control meant understanding how to start, operate, and shut down a compact nuclear reactor. That understanding, derived from Soviet hardware, would still be restricted data under U.S. law. The legal situation was absurd but entirely logical within the framework of nuclear secrecy. The Atomic Energy Act does not distinguish between domestic and foreign nuclear information. If data meets the definition of restricted data, it is classified, period. The fact that the Soviets had developed this information independently, that it represented their intellectual property, that NASA had legally purchased the hardware, none of that mattered. The moment American scientists began to analyze the reactors in ways that would generate detailed design information, they were creating restricted data. NASA owned the hardware but could not perform the engineering analysis that justified the purchase. They could look at the reactors, they could photograph them, they could measure external dimensions. But the detailed internal studies, the kind of analysis that would actually advance American space reactor technology, that required personnel with Q clearances working in approved facilities following restricted data handling procedures. The bureaucratic requirements were staggering. The Department of Energy, successor to the Atomic Energy Commission, controlled access to restricted data. NASA had to negotiate with DOE for permission to study hardware NASA owned. Facilities had to be certified. Personnel had to be cleared. Analysis plans had to be reviewed. Every measurement that might reveal design details had to be evaluated for classification implications. The process moved at the speed of federal bureaucracy managing nuclear secrecy, which is to say, it barely moved at all. Meanwhile, the reactors sat in storage. The knowledge they represented, the engineering solutions to space power problems, remained locked inside hardware that was physically present but legally inaccessible. Engineers who had spent careers working on American space reactor concepts could see Soviet solutions to their problems sitting in front of them, but they could not freely investigate those solutions. The irony compounded. The United States had spent billions of dollars over decades developing space reactor technology. Programs like SNAP-10A, which flew in 1965, and the SP-100 program in the 1980s, had pushed American capabilities forward. But funding was always uncertain, priorities always shifting. The Soviets, meanwhile, had committed to space reactors as a strategic technology. They flew over 30 reactor-powered satellites. They accumulated operational experience that American programs could only theorize about. And when the Soviet Union collapsed, that experience became theoretically available. Theoretically. Because in practice, American secrecy law created a barrier more effective than Cold War hostility. During the Cold War, the barrier was access. After the Cold War, the barrier was classification. The information was physically closer, but legally further away. Some analysis did eventually occur. DOE and NASA worked out arrangements. Certain studies were conducted under appropriate security controls. Papers were published with careful redactions. But the process was slow, expensive, and incomplete. The spontaneous collaboration that might have occurred between NASA engineers and Soviet-era hardware, the kind of hands-on investigation that drives real understanding, that never fully happened. The Topaz 2 acquisition was supposed to represent a peace dividend, a way for American space programs to benefit from Soviet expertise after decades of competition. Instead, it became a case study in how legal frameworks designed for one era can create absurd obstacles in another. The reactors were not secret in any meaningful sense. Their existence was known. Their basic design was published. The Soviets had offered them for sale, but the specific engineering knowledge embedded in their design remained locked behind classification barriers created by American law. This was not a failure of any individual or agency. The Atomic Energy Act's restricted data provisions serve legitimate purposes. Nuclear weapons information should be controlled. But the law makes no distinction between weapons-relevant information and information that merely happens to involve similar physics. A space reactor and a weapon both involve nuclear chain reactions in compact geometries. The physics overlaps. Therefore, the classification overlaps. The law is crude by necessity, and that crudeness creates casualties. The Topaz 2 story is one of those casualties. It represents potential knowledge not gained, engineering insights not absorbed, technological advancement not achieved, not because of technical barriers or lack of funding or political opposition, but because of legal classifications that treated Soviet hardware in American hands as if it were still secret American weapons data. Today, space nuclear power is experiencing renewed interest. NASA's Kilopower project has demonstrated small fission reactors for space applications. Mars missions and outer planet exploration require power sources beyond solar panels. The engineering challenges that Topaz 2 solved decades ago are being solved again, independently, by American engineers who cannot fully access the Soviet solutions sitting in storage. The reactors still exist, presumably, somewhere in the DOE complex. Physical objects representing a different approach to space nuclear engineering, a road not taken by American programs. They are artifacts now, historical curiosities, examples of hardware that crossed the Cold War divide but could not cross the legal barriers of nuclear secrecy. There is no villain in this story, no conspiracy or cover-up, just the intersection of Cold War secrecy law with post-Cold War cooperation, creating a situation where possession meant nothing without the legal right to understand. NASA bought the reactors, the United States owned them. But in the only sense that mattered for engineering progress, they remained as inaccessible as if they were still in Moscow. It is a small tragedy in the larger history of space exploration, one more example of how human institutions can obstruct human knowledge even when no one intends obstruction. The hardware was there. The opportunity was there. The legal framework made it impossible. And so the knowledge remained locked inside metal and uranium, owned but unknown, purchased but unstudied, a perfect symbol of potential unrealized not by physics or engineering, but by law. If you enjoyed this story, hit subscribe for more stories where history, technology, and human ambition collide. Thanks for watching.